Good morning, family. Welcome back to Karateng. Those of you who are watching us for the first time, welcome, welcome to our channel. I hope this is going to be worth your time. If it is, please subscribe. But anyway, this morning, I just want to show you a video of the wainscoting work that has been going on in one of our residences. And our guy, I think, has been amazing. His level of attention to detail and producing exactly what we needed was just on another level. Anyway, so if you're interested in wainscoting work, we've got a plaque. Look at the wall and how he's done an amazing job. However, if there's something you think we have missed on the walls, again, please feel free to let me know in the comment section. We'll be sure to make adjustments as needed. Now, as the title suggests, today I'm going to talk about the question of when. For those who are choosing to return to the village, when is a good time to return? And I'm going to describe a few things we've learned and share with you examples of what my wife and I are doing as we work our way back from Long Beach, California to Karateng in Kisumu. Now, the question of when to return home is one that really haunts most, if not all, returnees. And I'm including people who live in Kenya and live in the cities and those who live in different countries out there. People often wonder, should they wait till retirement? Should they move after quote-unquote making it or go back and forth? And the answers to each of these questions will vary quite a bit. And each option has its benefits and drawbacks that I'm going to highlight. But in truth, for those of us who live in diaspora, I have never met a single person who looks forward to retiring in diaspora and moving into a nursing home or an elderly facility. I don't know a single Kenyan or a single African who wants that. Many of us grapple with that question of where to live after retirement, but nobody wants to live in retirement homes. And so today I'm going to share some of the things we are doing to prepare ourselves for our eventual return to Karateng. Now, beginning with the trip from Kenya into diaspora, at the beginning, many of us worry less about the prospects of returning, in part because at the time we are leaving Kenya for diaspora for the first time, for the most part, I think we are focused on survival. Now, those of us who went to diaspora through school are just trying to make it through school, graduate, try to work. And many of us at that time are still very much excited about everything diaspora. And the lights are still very bright. And of course, in many cases, when you just move right in diaspora, chances are you're too broke to be traveling back home, or you probably don't have the right papers to go back and forth. And in fact, for me, I remember when I went to the US Embassy for my visa, I knew for sure that I never wanted to go back there to ask somebody to renew my visa. And so I knew I was going to have to do whatever I needed to do to not have to come back. And of course, when you're still new, it's likely that your mindset might be different. Many of us at that time are still thinking, oh, abroad good, home bad. That dichotomy where one is good and one is bad. And then of course, for the most part, we're just focusing on making it. So at that point, we are not really thinking about returning. Now, years down the road, the shine of diaspora begins to wear out. And then life begins to settle in this specific routine where many of us move between work and school, work and family, work and maybe a few social events here and there. And so after life begins to settle, nothing really new is happening in life. And so you begin wondering what's next. And then at that point, a lot of us are able to move home because they already have the papers or financially they can afford to travel. And traveling at home has this really powerful effect of rekindling the beautiful memories of growing up at home. For example, when I'm at home, sometimes I'm sitting outside just underneath the tree waiting to go prepare lunch. And then my sister walks out with a jar of warm water asking, hey, Wunodidi, can you wash your hands? And she's just pouring warm water on my hands. And it feels so, so good. So good, like I'm like, I miss that. Memories are really good things. The happy people around you, childhood memories about, like in my case in Karateng, we used to do skinny dipping, playing with animals, the freedom of kids just running around, great weather all year round, amazing food. And then, of course, you visit places that you spend time in. Like in my case, I spent a lot of my years living in Oyugis and in Karateng. So anytime I come back and I visit those places, my heart just sinks when I'm done and I'm walking away. And in fact, the worst part of visiting home is when we are heading back to JKA, heading back to diaspora. It's the longest flight. It's something I never look forward to. In fact, the worst part of it for me, beyond just the entire flight, is that flight from Kisumu to Nairobi, when I know all the fun is done and I'm going back to diaspora. So visiting home really, really makes you wonder, do I really want to go back often? And if so, how often do I want to go back? And then, of course, over time, when you live in diaspora, over many years, you start losing people. You lose like your grandparents, your siblings, your friends. And sometimes you go back, you hear somebody's died, or you come back for funerals, and you begin to wonder, how much time do I need to spend away from the people I love? And of course, as you grow older, priorities change. When we're younger, many of us don't think we'd ever come back. But as you grow older, and I've seen many of my friends who are in their 60s or 70s, who tell me that in their 40s and 30s, they never thought about moving back to Kenya. And now that they are retired or getting close to retirement, they're hustling to get themselves ready. And then, of course, the weather. And then lastly, when you live in diaspora, you get a chance to see functional systems. And all of us desire to bring that back home. So all these factors, after a while, really make you want to come back home. And so at some point, we realize that our desire to spend time home is much stronger than our desire to spend time in diaspora. And that's when the question of how and when becomes even more pertinent. And so when it comes to how people make it back home, I've seen two options. The first option is what I would call cold turkey, where somebody just wakes up, resigns, sells everything and goes back home. I've seen people do that successfully, others not quite so. Now, the vast majority of us pick the second option, which is figuring out an option that allows you to spend more time in Kenya than in diaspora. And that's what my wife and I are currently doing, where we are spending more time in Kenya, but going back to diaspora. This was another form of returning until we get to a point where we can formally transition. So those are some of the options that you know as far as the how. Now, in terms of when, again, say there are many, many answers here, but here are some of the 10 factors that folks have to think about before deciding when is the ideal time to transition back home. The first is your legal status. Do you have a green card or are you a citizen? Because as a green card holder, you can't be out of the US for more than 6 months. As a citizen, you can be gone for however long you want. And when you need to go back, you just buy a ticket and then you come back. Do you have school-age children? That's one of our biggest struggles right now. When you have younger children, you worry about disrupting them or finding options that would allow them to transition. Now, the kind of work you do also matters. Are you self-employed? Do you have a flexible job like contract nurses? Or can you work remotely? And then, of course, the question of whether or not a person has hassles back at home. And when it comes to hassles, I look at it in two ways. Number one, do you have something that can help you make money? And then number two, things that can keep you busy. Because remember, when you're returning home, you're not coming back for holiday fun. That's done. You need stuff that keeps you busy, something that gets you up in the morning. And then the question of spouses. Is your spouse ready to move with you or not? Or can you live with one person on the other side and the other person on this side? What kind of work does your spouse do? Are they on the same mindset as you? Do they have medical issues that may require them to travel back and forth? And then, of course, do you have a Kenyan spouse or not? Because if you have a Kenyan spouse, more than likely, they'll be on the same page as you. But that's not guaranteed. Non-Kenyan spouses may have the problem of not sharing the same passion we have about Kenya. And so that can be a problem. And then a major, major factor, do you have a home you can come back to? A home that is your own, or a home that is comfortable, particularly a home that has modern comforts like indoor plumbing, Wi-Fi, reliable power, water, and security. And then means of transport. Are you able to move from point A to point B? Do you have a car? Can you drive in Kenya? Because Kenya driving, I think, requires the Holy Spirit and a few other angels sometimes to make things work. And then do you have networks, especially with city folks, hospital, police, and things like that? Then there are cultural considerations. And in terms of timing too, when you actually travel to Kenya may also be influenced by things like election times. Sometimes that may not be the best time to arrive in Kenya. But outside elections, you should be fine. So here are some suggestions that I'm going to share that we are using, my wife and I, that may be important. Number one, like I said earlier, there is no definite timeline that everybody should use. No particular timeline that works for everybody. And so returning does not have to be a single event where you wake up one morning and then you move on. Most of us go back and forth. We simply increase the amount of time we spend in Kenya until we are able to really completely transition. Now, number three, we say start preparing early. I had a friend of mine who, by the time he was dying, he was homeless in Kenya and homeless in the US, in part because he didn't prepare early. By the time he started building, he was close to retirement, had medical issues, had been exploited, and so his story is a sad one. So prepare early. And then what I say is that every year, if you have decided that you're going to move home at some point, every year, just make sure you're doing something that moves you closer to that goal. It doesn't matter whether it's buying land or just bringing materials or doing homework. Just make sure that every year you're in diaspora, you are doing at least one thing that moves you closer to going home. And then number five, the kids. Visit with them or home as often as you can. Make sure that the home you are taking them to Kenya has basic comforts, like I mentioned earlier. And then with entertainment. Summer can be really boring for diaspora kids because they come and everybody's in school and they have nobody to play with. So like with my kids, I make sure that, of course, one has a sibling. We buy books and toys. We have created playgrounds at home. And then we take them to fun places. And then I say, if you have younger kids, visit schools, visit hospitals. And then make sure your retirement options are in place, both in Kenya and diaspora. Insurance, really important. Health insurance, there's some really good options locally. And then, of course, they also have insurance for final expenses in case a death occurs. You want to make sure you explore those options. And then the other part that can also help with keeping you busy is think about opportunities to give back. A lot of us are highly skilled in different fields. So when you come back home, spend time, look for opportunities that can allow you to give back. And some of those may actually turn out to be money-making, whether it's NGOs and things like that. Well, I hope this was beneficial. Thank you, and I'll see you in the next. Bye.